really interesting that how the timing of everything worked out. What I'm going to be sharing with you today is a message that I prepared back in March and never got to give because the Lord had me preach something else. And I don't know if you guys noticed when you drove in, but there's been a lot of trenching, dirt work done next door. And we're just to curb your curiosity, we're putting in a French drain around the house because underneath the house is lower than the rest of the ground around it. And whenever it rains, water runs under there and just pools underneath the house. So, and that causes problems. it causes settling problems, and then everything gets all wonky. And so we're putting in a French drain to try to drain the water away and keep that from happening. But because of that, we had to rent a piece of equipment to do that, a track hoe to make that trench with. That ground is hard. It's been, you know, we earlier in the year we got too much rain, but now we haven't had any for a while, and that ground is, it's starting to, you know, crack and so on because it's so dry, and most of that over there is that red clay, and man, that stuff is hard when it's dry. So we're very, I can't imagine, especially in this heat, trying to dig a trench like that by hand. I mean, that would be a nightmare. So anyway, we had a piece of rental equipment that we had to use while we had it, because we're paying for it. As a result, I didn't get really much time at all this week to do any kind of studying or anything, and so I felt like the Lord was just telling me, we'll take that message out and do that message. Well, the interesting thing about the message is we just stood and we declared the 10 words, and the biggest passage in those 10 words is the passage about Shabbat. And this is a message entitled About Shabbat. For the sake of the camera and the video, this is August 1st, 2015. And on the Hebrew calendar, the 16th day of Av, 5775. And this message is actually based off of a couple questions that were posed way years ago when I asked for people to submit questions that we might be able to answer periodically. And the two questions that were asked is, why do we need to keep the Shabbat? And how do we keep Shabbat? And so, what we want to start with is right at the very beginning of the Bible. If you've got a complete Jewish Bible, it's going to be page 2. In the complete Jewish Bible. Chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. You know, I'm sure that some of you have had these kinds of conversations with people before, as well as I have. When you try to talk to non-messianic believers about Shabbat, there's a particular belief structure and bent in that regards that has been around for centuries, because it was the day was changed by the early founders of the Catholic Church, changing the day of worship and gathering from Saturday to Sunday. And there's great resistance in the church against the notion that that convocation, and we'll get to the scripture here in a minute, that convocation should be on a Saturday. To me, and I guess not everybody sees it this way, but to me, the very fact that right at the very beginning of creation, that our God who created us and created the world and created the universe and everything that we know was the one who he himself took a Shabbat and said it was a good thing. And then later sends his son, who again, we're going to look at the specific scripture where he says this. His son then comes along and says, God made the Shabbat as a gift for mankind. And yet, the very people who are supposed to be following God and following his son Yeshua, in essence, thumb their nose and say, I don't want your gift. And I just, that blows my mind. And so anyway, at the very beginning, chapter 2, verses 2 and 3, it says, on the seventh day, God was finished with his work which he had made, so he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. Now, if it just stopped right there, then we would say, okay, so God rested on the seventh day. No big deal. But it doesn't stop there. It says God blessed the seventh day and separated it as holy. Now, what does it mean to be separated as holy? If God says to you as an individual, I am separating you out to make you holy, what does that mean? It means that you are for his purposes and his purposes alone. Okay? That's what that means. And so when this says that God separated the Shabbat day, the seventh day, out from the rest of the other days and made it holy, then what does that say about that day? Or this day, I should say. This day is for God and God alone. Okay? Because on that day, so the reason why he did this is because on that day God rested from all his work which he had created, so that it itself could produce. Okay? Now let's go over page 82 in the Complete Jewish Bible. I'm sorry for all you people that don't have Complete Jewish Bibles. I can't give you a page number. Shemot, Exodus chapter 20, verse 11. Shemot, Exodus 20, 11. So God sets the precedent at the beginning and then reinforces it within the 10 words Okay? Verse 11, for in 6 days Adonai made heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them, but on the seventh day he rested. This is why Adonai blessed the day Shabbat and separated it for himself. And like I said earlier, God did this as a gift. And so, if we turn back in Shemot, in Exodus chapter 16, verses 29 and 30, Moshe is speaking here. He says, look, Adonai has given you the Shabbat. This is why he is providing bread for 2 days on the sixth day. Each of you stay where you are. No one is to leave his place on the seventh day. So the people rested on the seventh day. God even went out of his way to give a double portion to the people so that they wouldn't have to go out and do any work on Shabbat. When God goes out of his way to do something for us, he's not arbitrary in anything that he does. He has purpose for everything. And therefore, it was important enough to him that the people rest on the Shabbat, that he made provision for them on the sixth day. Okay? So, he's even trying to help them out. Okay? To rest and to keep the Shabbat holy to him. And then over in Mark, chapter 2, verse 27, in the Complete Jewish Bible, 1265.
Mark what?
Mark 2, 27. Well, 27 and 28. This Yeshua speaking says, then he said to them, Shabbat was made for mankind, not mankind for Shabbat. So the Son of Man is Lord even of Shabbat. See, all of these verses that we're reading are building a case. A case for Shabbat, and a case against those who would say that there's nothing to Shabbat. Okay? Because what does it mean if Yeshua says, because he says, so the Son of Man, speaking about himself, the Son of Man is Lord even of Shabbat. What does he mean when he says that? He's basically identifying himself as the one who set up Shabbat and that he gets to make the rules about Shabbat. Okay? What is and is not acceptable on Shabbat? He is the Lord of Shabbat. He is the one who created the Shabbat. Okay? Now, if we're not convinced with the precedent that God set himself by what he did, his own actions, and we're not convinced with the fact that he gifted mankind with Shabbat, then let's go, you know, if you have a problem with that, then let's just go to purely what God has commanded. Okay? Any one of us here who who has either grown up in a home or who has raised children know that there are house rules. And when Papa and Mama set house rules and we don't obey house rules, there are negative consequences that come as a result of disobeying the rules. Okay? It's no different with God. God has set some house rules. And one of those house rules is Shabbat. So, if He set these house rules, and we will look at the scripture passages where it's very clear that that's the case, and you are not obeying the house rules, then what's the outcome? What's the result? Okay? Let's go back to Shemot, to Exodus chapter 20. We were there before. Going to be page 82 in the Complete Jewish Bible. We're going to read more of the verses in that section in regards to Shabbat. We're going to read verses 8 through 10. We read 11 a little bit earlier. But let's read 8 through 10. Remember the day, Shabbat, to set it apart for God. Okay? You have 6 days to labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is a Shabbat for Adonai your God. On it you are not to do any kind of work, not you, your son or your daughter, not your male or female slave, not your livestock, and not the foreigner staying with you inside the gates to your property. Okay? So everybody needs to cease work on that day. Then let's go over to page 96 in the Complete Jewish Bible, chapter 31 of Shemot, Exodus 31, 12 through 17. Adonai said to Moshe, tell the people of Israel, you are to observe my Shabbats, for this is a sign between me and you through all your generations, so that you will know that I am Adonai, who set you apart for me. Therefore, you are to keep my Shabbat, because it is set apart for you. Everyone who treats it as ordinary, now get this, must be put to death. For whoever does any work on it is to be cut off from his people, which is a synonym for dying. Okay? Whenever you read in the scripture, a person's going to be cut off, that means they will die. Okay? On 6 days, work will be done, will get done. But the seventh day is Shabbat for complete rest, set apart for Adonai. Whoever does any work on the day of Shabbat must be put to death. The people of Israel are to keep the Shabbat, to observe Shabbat through all their generations as a perpetual covenant. It is a sign between me and the people of Israel forever. For in 6 days Adonai made heaven and earth, but on the seventh day he stopped working and rested. Now, I want to stop and talk about this particular passage specifically, because the language in this passage is very clear. God is speaking to the people of Israel, and He says, this is a covenant sign between me and the people of Israel, very specifically. This is one of the passages where the non-Jewish believers, they'll bring up this passage and say, it doesn't apply to us, because we're not Jewish. Okay? God definitely, it's very clear, made Shabbat a covenant sign with the people of Israel. But what we read previous to this, God established the Shabbat and separated it and said that it is to be holy before there ever was a Jewish people.
Yeah.
Okay? So, just because he turned it into a specific covenant sign with the people of Israel does not negate the fact that all mankind is to keep the Shabbat. And in fact, if you want, this is not in my notes, but if you want to take this a step further, when it comes to the scripture passage in Romans chapter 11, where it basically tells us there's one olive tree, and that one olive tree is Israel, and the root is the Messiah, and the tree and all of its branches are getting fed from the sap that is coming from the Messiah up through the tree of Israel. And when you come to faith as a Gentile believer, you are grafted into that tree. You know the old saying, what's good for the goose is good for the gander? If you're grafted into the tree that is Israel, guess what? It applies to you too. Okay? So, the argument that because we're Gentile, it doesn't apply to us, does not fly, according to the scripture. Is Yeshua your Messiah? What did Yeshua say about the Shabbat? You're supposed to keep the Shabbat. Okay? All right, let's turn over to chapter 35. Same book, chapter 35, verses 1 and 2. Moshe assembled the whole community of the people of Israel and said to them, "These are the things which Adonai has ordered you to do. In 6 days work is to be done, but the seventh day is to be a holy day for you, a Shabbat of complete rest in honor of Adonai." So when we stop what we're doing and we have the complete rest, we are honoring Adonai by what we're doing. Whoever does any work on it is to be put to death. And then it goes on, you are not to kindle a fire in any of your homes on Shabbat. Now we're going to turn over into a different book, Vayikra, Leviticus, chapter 23, verse 3, page 136 in the complete Jewish Bible. So Vayikra, Leviticus 23:3. I want to call to your remembrance what I have taught you many times before, that when you see God in His Word repeat something at least one more time, then that means it's got importance to Him. When it comes to this particular issue, He repeats it over and over and over throughout the Word of God. And in fact, what He says in many of the prophets is part of the judgment that comes on them, on the people of Israel, is as a result of them not keeping Shabbat. "23:3, work is to be done on 6 days, but the seventh day is a Shabbat of complete rest, a holy convocation. You are not to do any kind of work. It is a Shabbat for Adonai, even in your homes." Now, this particular passage has an addition. that people many times miss. And that is the phrase, a holy convocation. What does a holy convocation mean? Convocation means the assembling of God's people. So it's not just enough to cease your work and not work. What God says is, on top of not doing work, I want you guys to come together on this day before me. Okay? It's to be a holy convocation. Okay. And then let's turn over, well, actually we don't need to turn to that passage. In Devarim, we just read it when I read the 10 words today, in Devarim chapter 5, verses 12 through 15. If you're taking notes, you can jot that down. It is a repeat of the 10 words. And it just repeats the command that we read in Shemot, in Exodus. Okay? All right. From the passages that we have here, and a few others, God makes some very specific statements in regards to how to keep Shabbat. Okay? Other aspects of Shabbat are gray. And it was the gray areas where I've talked to you guys about the yoke of a rabbi. The rabbis were able to identify 613 commands in the Torah that the people of Israel were supposed to, according to God, the people of Israel were supposed to keep these 613 commands. There are always situations that will come up where, in an attempt to try to keep one command, the possibility exists that you're going to violate another command. Okay? And so, the rabbis, each of the schools of rabbinic thought, this goes way back before Yeshua came along. Okay? This was already established. The different schools of Judaism would rank the 613 commands in order of importance. So as the people of Israel were going about their daily work, if two or more of the commands conflicted with one another, they would know which of the commands had priority over the others. Okay? Now, the rabbis, the different schools of Judaism, they didn't agree on that order. But every rabbi, no matter which of the main, there were two main schools when Yeshua came on the scene, there were two main schools of Judaism. There was the school of Hillel and the school of Shammai. And they were like night and day different from one another as far as how they approached Judaism and applied it in life. And so there were two main schools, but underneath that you had a lot of sub-schools. You had various rabbis that had their own little yeshivas. They may mainly camp on Hillel's side or mainly camp on Shammai's side of things, but they had their own little skew. Okay? So you had all of the rabbis had their own yoke. Okay? Their own list of priorities of the 613. And you know, when Yeshua says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, because my yoke is easy and my burden is light," what he is in essence saying is, the way that I have things ordered is the right way, and if you do it like I tell you to do it, it's going to be a whole lot easier than the way these other guys are telling you how to do it. Okay? And So when it comes to those kinds of things where there's kind of gray areas and there are commands that oppose one another, there's argument and debate about those. But there are some very specific things that God has said to do or not do that we need to go over. First of all, and you've heard it already in multiple passages that we read, but if you want a passage that says it specifically, it would be Shemot or Exodus chapter 20, verse 10. So the first order of business is no ordinary work. No ordinary work. In Shemot, Exodus chapter 35, verse 3, earlier we read 1 and 2, verse 3, I also added that in, do not kindle a fire on Shabbat. In Shemot, Exodus 35, 2, and other passages, rest. It's to be a day to rest. In Shemot, Exodus 20, verse 8, we're instructed to set the day apart for the Lord. So it's for His purposes. He gets to call the shots of what happens and doesn't happen on this day. Okay. In Vayikra, Leviticus chapter 16, verse 31, this is to be perpetual. It says, through all your generations. And then in Vayikra, Leviticus 23:3, that we just read earlier, is to be a day to assemble before the Lord. Now for your sake, and again, here's where debate begins. But according to rabbinics, or Orthodox rabbinics, the definition of work is the act of creating. Okay? So on Shabbat, you don't create anything. Now, if you know anything about Rabbinic Judaism and what they allow and prohibit on Shabbat, then you know that it actually goes beyond just that one word of creating. Okay. In the most strict Orthodox homes, there are a number of things that you are not allowed to do. Because in their estimation, it is considered work. Can't pick up a pen or a pencil to write with. You can't turn the light switch on in your home or in the synagogue. If you've ever wondered why synagogues are made with lots of windows, that's the reason. To let sunlight in so you don't have to use electricity on Shabbat. In their estimation, flipping the switch is kindling a fire. That's the way they've defined it or determined it to be. Some of the things, you know, we hear, we think are ridiculous, and we laugh at, but they're serious about it. Before the Shabbat begins, you go into your restroom and you tear off the amount of toilet paper, unroll the roll and tear off the amount of toilet paper that you believe you're going to need for the Shabbat day, and you have it folded and stacked up ready to use, so you don't have to do the act of unrolling and tearing the toilet paper, because that's considered work. So they're very strict. And I've told you also about in Israel, they've gone back and forth on the issue of what they call the Shabbat elevator. Okay. In Israel, in a lot of the high-rise buildings, they have had what was called a Shabbat elevator, which basically all it did all day long on Shabbat was go up floor by floor by floor, stop at every floor, and then come down floor by floor by floor. It does that all day long, and you just have to wait to get on, because they don't want you pushing any buttons to make the elevator come down to where you are or go up or anything. So you just get on, you wait until it comes and opens up at your level. If it's going down, you're going down. Okay? If you live on the 10th floor and you happen to get on the elevator at the 5th floor and it's going down, you're going to go down 5 floors and then you're going to go up 10 floors. Okay? That's just the way it is. But now, I mean, that's the way it was. Now they're even saying you can't use Shabbat elevators in Israel on the Shabbat. Okay? Because it's still using electricity to run the elevator. So instead, if you live on the 10th floor, now on Shabbat, you get to schlep all your stuff up 10 flights of stairs. And somehow that's not working. So, there are these things where they debate and they come up with these decisions, and in Israel you just live with whatever the decision is. But so there's debate over certain aspects of how to keep the Shabbat. So the main thing, and one of the things that has been a point of contention in this specific congregation, is the issue of whether or not to spend money on Shabbat to get food. Okay? And we're not going to set a hard and fast rule in the congregation and say you must or you must not. Okay? You have to eat. Okay? And how you choose to do that is up to you. If you want to spend the time on Friday before Shabbat to prepare something, have it already prepared, and you just eat it on Shabbat, that is up to you. Okay? If you're okay with the idea that if you're not going to go out and buy gasoline or go to the grocery store and go shopping or to the mall or whatever, but you have to eat, and you spend money in order to get food to eat, that's something that's available here, okay? We don't see a problem with that. That was one of the issue of where Yeshua and the Talmidim are walking through the field. And according to rabbinics, the act of the guys, they're hungry, the act of the Talmidim just grabbing a stalk of wheat and stripping the grain and rubbing it in their hands to get the chaff off and then popping the grains into their mouth to eat, they were scolded by the religious that they were working on the Shabbat. And Yeshua goes to takes them to task over the issue and says, look, these guys are hungry. They have to eat somehow. So you would starve them on the Shabbat, which that flies in the face of another ruling on Shabbat that you're not to fast on Shabbat. Okay? So it's like you're making this impossible for people to do what they need to do. So we actually have had some people leave the congregation because we said it's okay if you need to go out and pay money to get food on Shabbat, to eat your lunch. And it's like, sorry. From what I can see in the Word, there are exceptions made for certain circumstances, and one of them is eating on the Shabbat. So anyway, not to get into a confrontation on that, but Yeshayahu, Isaiah. Now we want to take a look at some passages outside of the Torah itself. Isaiah 58, 13 and 14. This is page 529 in the Complete Jewish Bible. Yeshayahu, Isaiah 58, 13 and 14. This is the Lord speaking through Isaiah. If you hold back your foot on Shabbat from pursuing your own interests on my holy day, if you call Shabbat a delight, Adonai's holy day worth honoring, then honor it by not doing your usual things or pursuing your interests or speaking about them. If you do, you will find delight in Adonai. I will make you ride on the heights of the land and feed you with the heritage of your ancestor Yaakov, for the mouth of Adonai has spoken. Do you think this is important to God? Okay, not only does he say, if you won't keep the Shabbat, then you're going to get punished. He says, if you will keep the Shabbat, if you'll honor me in this, then I'm going to bless you as a result of doing this. I want to do a little bit of an experiment at this moment in time, because I've heard this periodically from various individuals, but not from everyone. I know many of you are coming from Gentile Christian backgrounds. And you came into this, when you came into this, everything was brand new. You probably didn't know anything. And so you've been learning and you've been experiencing as you've been coming here. By a show of hands, I would just like to see for my own curiosity, because I've heard this from numerous of you. When you started keeping the Shabbat, how many of you can say that you saw a change in your life, of increased blessing on your life? Yeah. God keeps His word. Matityahu, Matthew, chapter 12. Beginning with verse 1, 1237 in the Complete Jewish Bible. Matityahu, Matthew 12, 1 through 15a. one Shabbat, during that time, Yeshua was walking through some wheat fields. Ah, here we go with this story. His Talmidim were hungry, so they began picking heads of grain and eating them. On seeing this, the Perushim said to him, "Look, your Talmidim are violating Shabbat." But he said to them, "Haven't you ever read what David did when he and those with him were hungry? He entered the house of God and ate the bread of the presence, which was prohibited, both to him and to his companions. It is permitted only to the Kohanim." Now, why would he use that as the example? Huh? Yeah. What should have happened to David as a result of having done that? He should have died. Okay? According to the commands of God, the priests and the Levites were the only ones that should be eating that. Okay? So, why did David not die as a result of eating the bread of the presence? They were hungry. It was the only thing that they had at hand to eat. Okay? And God, understanding the situation, knew that David was not, it was not an act of rebellion against God. It was, we've got to have food. And God granted them mercy in that situation. Okay? If it was so important to God that those men be able to eat when they were hungry, that He spared their lives in eating the very bread of the presence in the Mishkan, how much more so than them stripping grain as they're walking through a field? That's the point Yeshua is trying to make. Okay? Or haven't you read in the Torah that on Shabbat, the Kohanim, I lost my place here. Five. Or haven't you read in the Torah that on Shabbat, the Kohanim profane Shabbat and yet are blameless? I tell you, there is in this place something greater than the temple. Now, what did he mean by they profane Shabbat and yet are blameless? They work. Okay? On Shabbat, they have to do all the same work that they do the rest of the week because that's their job. Okay? They still have to offer the sacrifices that God required to be offered on a daily basis. Okay? And now, it was special on Shabbat. There were some things that they didn't do on Shabbat, but they nevertheless had to work on Shabbat in the temple. Okay? So, and by the way, just to let you know, in case you don't know, as a result of this, not what Yeshua says, but as a result of this concept and this idea that there are some people that have to work on Shabbat because they don't have any choice. In Rabbinic Judaism, they cut the women slack when it comes to working on Shabbat because they understand there are things that a woman has to do for her family that she can't not do on Shabbat. She has to take care of her kids. Okay? If her kids fall in the mud, she's got to wash them. You know, there are things that a wife and mother has to do, even if it is Shabbat. Okay? Seven. If you knew what
I want compassion rather than animal sacrifice meant, you would not condemn the innocent. For the Son of Man is Lord of Shabbat.
There he says it again. He's Lord of Shabbat. So, what's the issue? He says it right there. If you knew what I want compassion rather than animal sacrifice meant, you would not condemn the innocent. So it's an issue of compassion. Okay? All right, Luke chapter 13.
So on this one you had to go to 15a, so there was a little bit more on
I didn't read that, huh? Well,
it's about the healing of the man with the shriveled hand, I think.
12. Oh, yes. Okay. Okay, so he makes a point about compassion. And then going on from that place, he went into their synagogue. A man there had a shriveled hand. Looking for a reason to accuse him of something, they asked him, is healing permitted on Shabbat? But he answered, so they didn't get the point that Yeshua had made before about compassion. But he answered, if you have a sheep that falls in a pit on Shabbat, which of you won't take hold of it and lift it out? How much more valuable is a man than a sheep? Therefore, what is permitted on Shabbat is to do good. Then to the man he said, hold out your hand. As he held it out, it became restored, as sound as the other one. But the Perushim went out and began plotting how they might do away with Yeshua. Aware of this, he left that area. Let me give you as you're turning to Luke 13, let me give you a parabolic situation. Let's say that you had a next door neighbor who had been sick. And maybe you had been taking stuff, you know, food to the person or whatever. But his yard is overgrown and the city comes along and says, you need to cut your grass. You need to have it cut. We're going to come back out here on Monday to check to see whether your grass is cut on Monday. And if we come back here and your grass is not cut by Monday, we're going to fine you. Would it be okay to mow the guy's lawn on Shabbat?
Yep.
Yes. So, you know, Yeshua is trying to make these kinds of things, make the people understand. This cannot be a hard, fast rule to the point where you elevate the Shabbat day above human beings and the care of human beings. Okay? There are other situations, not Shabbat, but there are other situations where the rabbis through the centuries ruled in certain ways that goes totally against what the Torah says. For instance, during the Holocaust, in the internment camps, they were starving to death. And the rabbis said, whatever you can get your hands on and put in your mouth, you can eat, in order to stay alive. They had to suspend the commands of the Torah in order to live. Okay? So there are these situations where there has to be exceptions to the rule under certain mitigating circumstances. So Luke 13, 10 through 17, page 1311 in the Complete Jewish Bible. Yeshua was teaching in one of the synagogues on Shabbat. A woman came up
who had a spirit which had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent double and unable to stand erect at all. On seeing her, Yeshua called her and said to her, "Lady, you have been set free from your weakness." He put his hands on her, and at once she stood upright and began to glorify God. But the president of the synagogue, indignant that Yeshua had healed on Shabbat, spoke up and said to the congregation, "There are 6 days in the week for working, so come during those days to be healed, not on Shabbat." However, the Lord answered, "You hypocrites, each one of you on Shabbat, don't you loose your ox or your donkey from the stall and lead him off to drink? This woman is a daughter of Abraham, and the adversary kept her tied up for 18 years. Shouldn't she be freed from this bondage on Shabbat?" By these words, Yeshua put to shame the people who opposed him. But the rest of the crowd were happy about all the wonderful things that were taking place through him. And then let's go over to Yohanan, John. And there's going to be several passages that we read. In Yohanan 5, chapter 5, verses 1 through 24, 1335 in the Complete Jewish Bible. These will be the last passages that we read on the subject. Yohanan 5, John 5, 1 through 24. After this, there was a Judean festival, and Yeshua went up to Jerusalem. In Jerusalem, by the sheep gate, is a pool called in Aramaic, Beit Zata, surrounded by five porches, in which lay a crowd of invalids, blind, lame, crippled. One man was there who had been ill for 38 years. Yeshua, seeing this man and knowing that he had been there a long time, said to him, "Do you want to be healed?" How would you like to be asked that by Yeshua? Woo! You wouldn't say, "No." The sick man answered, "I have no one to put me in the pool when the water is disturbed. And while I'm trying to get there, someone goes in ahead of me." Yeshua said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat and walk." Immediately the man was healed, and he picked up his mat and walked. Now that day was Shabbat. Oh my goodness. How dare he roll up his mat and walk around with it? So the Judeans said to the man who had been healed, "It's Shabbat. It's against Torah for you to carry your mat." But he answered them, "The man who healed me, he's the one who told me, 'Pick up your mat and walk.'" I'm just obeying. They asked him, "Who is the man who told you to pick it up and walk?" But the man who had been healed didn't know who it was, because Yeshua had slipped away into the crowd. Afterwards, Yeshua found him in the temple court and said to him, "See, you're well. Now, stop sinning, or something worse may happen to you." Oh my. The man went off and told the Judeans it was Yeshua who had healed him. And on account of this, the Judeans began harassing Yeshua because he did these things on Shabbat. But he answered them, "My Father has been working until now, and I too am working." This answer made the Judeans all the more intent on killing him. Not only was he breaking Shabbat, but also by saying that God was his own father, he was claiming equality with God. Therefore, Yeshua said this to them, "Yes, indeed, I tell you that the Son cannot do anything on his own, but only what he sees the Father doing. Whatever the Father does, the Son does too. For the Father loves the Son and shows him everything he does, and he will show him even greater things than these, so that you will be amazed. Just as the Father raises the dead and makes them alive, so too the Son makes alive anyone he wants. The Father does not judge anyone, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, so that all may honor the Son as they honor the Father. Whoever fails to honor the Son is not honoring the Father who sent him. Yes, indeed, I tell you that whoever hears what I'm saying and trusts the one who sent me has eternal life. That is, he will not come up for judgment, but he has already crossed over from death to life." Now let's take a look at what is being said here. Already we have established through the words of Yeshua, Yeshua is the Lord of Shabbat. In other words, he's the one who gets to tell us what is acceptable and what's not acceptable on the Shabbat. Okay? And we already established that when we keep the Shabbat, we honor God. Yeshua says, if you don't keep the Shabbat like it was instructed and like I'm telling you, and you dishonor me, you're dishonoring my Father. So, I mean, they don't mince words on this issue. Chapter 7, page 1338. After this, Yeshua traveled around in the Galilee, intentionally avoiding Yehuda because the Judeans were out to kill him. But the festival of Sukkot in Yehuda was near, so his brothers said to him, "Leave here and go into Yehuda so that your Talmidim can see the miracles you do. For no one who wants to become known acts in secret. If you're doing these things, show yourself to the world." His brothers spoke this way because they had not put their trust in him. So basically it was a challenge. If you really are who you say you are, then you should be out there where everybody can see you. Okay? Yeshua said to them, "My time has not yet come." What does that mean? My time has not yet come. My time to die hasn't come. Okay? So he's avoiding Yehuda because they're after him to kill him. And his brothers, who don't really believe that he's the Messiah and don't really believe in him, they're saying, "Well, if you're all everything that you're saying that you are, then you need to be out there showing off for everybody." And Yeshua says, "Yeah, you don't understand. It's not time for me to die yet. I'm not going to go over there, put myself in harm's way." "But for you, any time is right."
Woo! Look out now.
You know, people try to make Yeshua out to be otherworldly, almost stoic and no sense of humor and I don't think he was like that. The world can't hate you, but it does hate me because I keep telling it how wicked its ways are. You, go on up to the festival. As for me, I'm not going up to the festival now because the right time has not yet come.
Having said this, he stayed on in the Galil. But after his brothers had gone up to the festival, he too went up, not publicly, but in secret. At the festival, the Judeans were looking for him. "Where is he?" they asked. And among the crowds, there was much whispering about him. Some said, "He's a good man." But others said, "No, he's deceiving the masses." However, no one spoke about him openly for fear of the Judeans. Not until the festival was half over did Yeshua go up to the temple courts and begin to teach. The Judeans were surprised. "How does this man know so much without having studied?" they asked. So Yeshua gave them an answer. "My teaching is not my own. It comes from the one who sent me. If anyone wants to do his will, he will know whether my teaching is from God or I speak on my own. A person who speaks on his own is trying to win praise for himself, but a person who tries to win praise for the one who sent him is honest. There is nothing false about him. Didn't Moshe give you the Torah? Yet not one of you obeys the Torah. Why are you out to kill me?" "You have a demon," the crowd answered. "Who's out to kill you?" Yeshua answered them, "I did one thing, and because of this, all of you are amazed. Moshe gave you Brit Milah. Not that it came from Moshe, but from the patriarchs. And you do a boy's Brit Milah on Shabbat. If a boy is circumcised on Shabbat, so that the Torah of Moshe will not be broken, why are you angry with me because I made a man's whole body well on Shabbat? Stop judging by surface appearances and judge the right way." Some of the Yerushalayim people said, "Isn't this the man they're out to kill? Yet here he is speaking openly and they don't say anything to him." It couldn't be, could it, that the authorities have actually concluded he's the Messiah? Surely not. We know where this man comes from. But when the Messiah comes, no one will know where he comes from. Whereupon Yeshua, continuing to teach in the temple courts, cried out, "Indeed, you do know me, and you know where I'm from. And I have not come on my own. The one who sent me is real, but him you don't know. I know him because I'm with him, and he sent me." At this, they tried to arrest him, but not one laid a hand on him because his time had not yet come. However, many in the crowd put their trust in him and said, "When the Messiah comes, will he do more miracles than this man has done?" The Parashim heard the crowd whispering these things about Yeshua, so the head Kohanim and the Parashim sent some of the temple guards to arrest him. Yeshua said, "I will be with you only a little while longer, then I will go away to the one who sent me. You will look for me and not find me. Indeed, where I am, you cannot come." The Judeans said to themselves, "Where's this man about to go that we won't find him? Does he intend to go to the Greek diaspora and teach the Greek-speaking Jews? And when he says, 'You will look for me and not find me, indeed, where I am, you cannot come,' what does he mean?" Now on the last day of the festival, Hoshana Rabbah, Yeshua stood and cried out, "If anyone is thirsty, let him keep coming to me and drinking. Whoever puts his trust in me, as the scripture says, rivers of living water will flow from his inmost being." Now he said this about the Spirit, whom those who trusted in him were to receive later. The Spirit had not yet been given because Yeshua had not yet been glorified. I had down the whole chapter, but it doesn't continue to talk about Shabbat. So let's move on and finish up with chapter 9. So all of this has already gone on in chapter 9. This is further down the road of time. As Yeshua passed along, he saw a man blind from birth. His Talmidim asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, to cause him to be born blind?" Yeshua answered, "His blindness is due neither to his sin nor to that of his parents. It happened so that God's power might be seen at work in him. As long as it is day, we must keep doing the work of the one who sent me. The night is coming when no one can work. While I'm in the world, I am the light of the world." Having said this, he spit on the ground, made some mud with the saliva, which, by the way, was a specific rabbinic command on the books in regards to Shabbat. And in fact, I think it's still on the books today in Israel: thou shalt not spit on the Shabbat. Okay? Because if you spit, it mixes with the dirt and becomes mud, which is mortar, and it's doing work. Okay? You're making mortar by spitting on the ground and you're working, so you can't spit on the Shabbat. Not only did he spit, but he got down there and mixed it up. Okay? And then he took this mixture and put it on the man's eyes and said to him, "Go wash off in the pool of Siloah." The name means sent. So he went and washed and came away seeing. Okay? Which that part of it was forbidden too. The washing part of it was also forbidden for that man to do, because that would be considered working on the Shabbat. Okay? So not only does Yeshua violate the Shabbat in their estimation, but then he commands the man he's healing to go violate the Shabbat too. Okay? His neighbors and those who previously had seen him begging said, "Isn't this the man who used to sit and beg?" Some said, "Yes, he's the one," while others said, "No, but he looks like him." However, he himself said, "I am the one." "Well, how were your eyes opened?" they asked. He answered, "The man called Yeshua made mud, put it on my eyes, and told me, 'Go to Siloah and wash.' So I went, and as soon as I had washed, I could see." They said to him, "Where is he?" And he replied, "I don't know." They took the man who had been blind to the Perishim. Now the day on which Yeshua had made the mud and opened his eyes was Shabbat. Oh my. So the Perishim asked him again how he had become able to see. And he told him, "He put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I can see. How many times do I have to tell you?" At this, some of the Perishim said, "This man is not from God, because he doesn't keep Shabbat." But others said, "How could a man who is a sinner do miracles like these?" And there was a split among them. So once more they spoke to the blind man, "Since you're the one whose eyes he opened, what do you say about him?" He replied, "He is a prophet." The Judeans, however, were unwilling to believe that he had formerly been blind, but now could see, until they had summoned the man's parents. They asked them, "Is this your son, who you say was born blind? How is it that now he can see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son, and that he was born blind, but how it is that he can see now, we don't know, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he's old enough. He can speak for himself." The parents said this because they were afraid of the Judeans, for the Judeans had already agreed that anyone who acknowledged Yeshua as the Messiah would be banned from the synagogue. This is why his parents said, "He's old enough, ask him." So a second time they came to the man who had been blind, and they said to him, "Swear to God that you will tell the truth. We know that this man is a sinner." He answered, "All right, whether he's a sinner or not, I don't know. One thing I do know, I was blind, and now I see." So they said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" This poor guy. "I already told you," he answered, "and you didn't listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Maybe you too want to become his Talmidim." Then they railed at him. "You may be his Talmid," they said, "but we are Talmidim of Moshe. We know that God has spoken to Moshe, but as for this fellow, we don't know where he's from." "What a strange thing," the man answered, "that you don't know where he's from, considering that he opened my eyes." We know that God doesn't listen to sinners. So here's this untrained, untaught guy teaching the teachers. Okay? In all history, no one has ever heard of someone's opening the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he couldn't do a thing. "Why, you momser," they retorted, which, bad thing to say. Momser means bastard, okay?
Whoa.
They retorted, "Are you lecturing us?" And they threw him out. Yeshua heard that they had thrown the man out. He found him and said, "Do you trust in the Son of Man?" "Sir," he answered, "tell me who he is so that I can trust in him." Yeshua said to him, "You have seen him. In fact, he's the one speaking with you right now." "Lord, I trust." He said, and he kneeled down in front of him. Yeshua said, "It is to judge that I came into this world, so that those who do not see might see, and those who do see might become blind." Some of the Perishim nearby heard this and said to him, "So we're blind too, are we?" Yeshua answered them, "If you are blind, you would not be guilty of sin. But since you still say, 'We see,' your guilt remains." So, about Shabbat, very, very clearly, God says this is a very special day. It's my day. I've set it apart as holy to me. It's just supposed to be for me. I want you to rest. I want you to convocate with the assembly of the people of Israel. I want you to worship me and serve me. And there are occasions where you'll have to do things on Shabbat that others might say is violating Shabbat. But the motivation, it's the motivation for what you're doing that matters. Okay? If you're violating the Shabbat just because you believe, "Well, I can do this and get away with it," wrong motivation for doing anything that God says not to do. But in the heart of God, there's mercy and compassion for the needs of people. And exceptions are made in that case. So, this may have caused more questions in your mind than answered. But if that's the case, I guess you can always ask me. And I'll try to help you. If there's something specific maybe that you're dealing with on Shabbat and you don't really know whether it's kosher for you to be doing it, then we'll talk. Not that I'll give you a black and white answer and say, thus saith the Lord, but we'll talk about it. Yes?
I was raised in a Christian Gentile family, and my grandmother, we weren't allowed to work on Sundays, but my grandmother always said, unless the ox got in the ditch.
Yeah.
That was...
Ox in the ditch.
Yeah.
And sometimes we have those. It's really interesting. That brings up, just very briefly, it brings up something that happened to me many years ago. And I don't really remember now what it was that was going on in our home. But this was way back when we were at Baruch Hashem. I was not a rabbi. There was something going on at home, and I kept missing Shabbat days because of needing to do whatever. I can't even remember what it was. And a young man that was at the congregation would ask Deborah each Shabbat that I would miss, where's Michael? And Deborah would say, well, he felt like he needed to stay home to take care of whatever this was. And she would use the term, he's got an ox in the ditch. Well, after several times of this, where I didn't show up for Shabbat services at Baruch Hashem, he sent a note home with her. And the note, it was folded over, little note, and I opened it up and read, and it very simply said, don't let the oxen rule your life. Don't let the oxen rule your life. And that made a huge impression on me. And I don't know that guy really understands, even to this day, what kind of an impact that had on me, because just from that little note, it was like, okay, I have misstepped, and from now on, it is going to need to be an absolute emergency before I miss Shabbat services again. So, all right, let's pray. Abba, probably in many ways, with this particular group of people in this room, as the old saying goes, I'm probably by and large preaching to the choir and not needing to necessarily convince the people in this room of what the scripture says about Shabbat. Otherwise they wouldn't be coming here on Shabbat. But Father, maybe there were some things that were clarified today for them. And I know for those who watch the video on YouTube, this message may be revelatory for them. And so, Father, however you want to use it, it's your word, it's your desire. And so, Father, we just submit all of this to you. We ask, Lord, that in the spirit, in the proper spirit, not of rigidity, not of legalistic Torah observance, but in a heart of love to honor you, may we keep the Shabbat as is in your heart. In Yeshua's name, amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace.
Yevarech Adonai v'yishmarecha. Ya'er Adonai panav alecha v'yikunecha. Oh.
Shlichenu Adonenu Tzidkenu Yeshuatenu, Sar Shalom. In the name of Yeshua, our Messiah, our Lord, our righteousness, our salvation, the Prince of Peace. Amen.